The Laura Plantation was set for demolition in the early 1980s in order to build a new Mississippi River bridge. However, an earthquake fault line subsequently saved the plantation. But in 2004, there was a devastating fire that nearly destroyed the old sugarcane house, if not for the fast work of some firefighters and a little bit of luck. At the Laura Plantation in St. James Parish, it's not about the buildings on the 13-acre site. It's all about the stories that lie within.
The other half of the slaves were here, laying the foundation to this house. They made all of these bricks from the Mississippi River clay.
Over 200 years of memories ring out here in Vacherie, all for visitors from around the world to experience firsthand. Your recollection of plantation history may not ring a bell from the version depicted here. Park your Hollywood perceptions of Gone with the Wind at the door. This is a Creole plantation. You will not see the ornate white pillared main house that was typical of the American plantation owner.
It's not a typical Southern plantation home because South Louisiana was not typically the South. We had a different culture here from the very beginning. It was not the white Anglo-Saxon Protestant culture of the rest of the South. And this typifies what was in Louisiana. These people who lived here, this was a place where they came to work, sugar plantation. They did not want people to know how wealthy they were. It's a place where only French was spoken. And both the French and the Alsatian family were Creole families. And so when we saw this place in the late 1980s, early 1990s, we realized it was rare because of what had happened here and how it typified the older culture of Louisiana.
The plantation is named after Laura Lacoula Gore, the great-granddaughter to the original owner, Guillaume Duparc. Thanks to the thousands of documents retrieved from the National Archives in Paris, along with Laura's 150-page memoir, history lives on.
She told her dad when she was 14 she wants to grow up to be a modern, liberated American. Now, liberated to her meant to be liberated from the burdens of the plantation.
The 200-year-old Laura Plantation main house, also known as the Maison Principale, was almost history itself when a fire broke out in August of 2004. Fire could be seen for miles, and if not for some very fortunate breaks, this facility would have been lost forever.
So it was traumatic. Most of the people who work here, we have about 35 were here, and we were all in shock. But the firemen were incredibly skilled. They, believe it or not, they were having a meeting of three fire departments about two blocks away, and so when they got the call, they were here. They saved this house. The tin roof had come down and was likely to fall off, and it would take the walls with them. So every room was scaffolded and braced with iron and these braces here. It is endangered, but we have such wonderful friends, and we've had such incredible support from not only Whitney Plantation, but Homus House and Oak Alley and Evergreen, that, you know, we're in good shape. And our attendance is still good, and that, of course, pays all the rest of the bills.
Fortunately, attendance did not cool off after the blaze. In fact, they set a record in 2004 with 110,000 visitors. Here, history is not sugar-coated in the cane fields, and the story of the hundreds of slaves working on this 12,000-acre farm is far from overlooked.
You have to understand that when Laura was born here, 15 people who lived on the site were free and 185 were enslaved. Can't get past that fact. But let me tell you, people who come here are interested in finding out what really happened on this place. In the slave quarters that still stand, were written down the stories about Compère Lapin, Compère Bouquet, the stories of a clever rabbit and stupid fool. A teenager, 18 years old, by the name of Alcee Forche, came to Laura, went to the neighboring plantations, and he wrote down these stories. They would later be adapted and published in English as the Tales of Burr Rabbit. They were written here in French by the slaves that had come down from Senegal in the 1720s. And that's an important part of our heritage that we did not want to lose. Laura, who is born during the Civil War and lives until President Kennedy, 1963, almost 102 years, gets a good idea, I think, of what how things changed. She will write in her memoirs that the Civil War came and the Civil War left, and nothing changed on this place. The inequities that she saw of the workers and the owners persisted. There was still a lot of poverty out here in the river region, all the way into the 1880s and 1890s when she would finally leave. I think that's what we get from her writings, is that you really see a continuity of history. And that's what makes this place rare, because now we have a wonderful personal insight into the way life was like after the Civil War and well before the Civil War.